buying a pole is liable to be the most expensive item of fishing tackle that you're ever going to purchase. And whether you're a match or a pleasure angler, there are quite a few things that you need to look out for when you're buying a new pole. And we'll have a look to help you maybe make a much better informed decision. Now, this is a scenario that we will all have seen. You go to a show or you go to a big tackle shop and there's the pole alley and you're presented with a seat box and a pole in front of you. And you're going to probably get 2 minutes to take a look at this pole and waggle it around a bit. So in those 2 minutes, let's take a look at a few checks that you can do just to make sure that it meets the criteria that you're looking for. So the first thing you need to do is, no matter whether the pole is 13 meters, 14 or 16 meters, lengthwise, do not start it at its full length. Start it from a length or two back from the butt sections. So this is a 16 meter pole, we'll start it at 13. And the idea is you're gonna get a feel to what happens to it when you start to put the other sections on, because you might, you know, you're looking for the rigidity to not go too much. You're looking for it to not go top heavy. You know, if it feels really top heavy, maybe not quite the pole that you're looking for. And also you're looking for not too much bouncing around at the tip end. And we'll deal with the tip end in a minute, but they're the things that you're looking for in that initial little pickup where you're gonna take the pole forward. So once you've established that it's not wobbling around like a jelly on a plate, or that it looks like a stick of rhubarb, the next most important thing is to have a look at that tip, the very end of the tip. Now, nearly all poles are designed with a match kit in them, not a carp kit, with a match kit, because with a match kit in them, they're all much lighter. So make sure that you've got a carp kit or a power kit stuck in that end of it. And then if they'll let you, move the roller right up to the tip end, put the tip on the roller and just pick it up as if you were striking. And what you're looking for is it to come up really cleanly without knocking the roller a couple of times. So if it comes up without knocking it at all, you know that there's hardly any post-strike recoil and it's quite a quick pole. And it doesn't have to be a flagship pole for that to happen. You know, there's many, many sort of 12 meter poles or 30 meter poles that can do that very nicely. But you don't have to go cloud busting. You know, that's not going to happen. There's no point to do that because you're very direct with the pole. It's just a matter of picking it up, but picking it up quickly, and you're looking for no knock. So it's the no knock tip we want. So after you've had a look at the tip and you felt what it's like for rigidity, what we're going to do is we're going to have a look at the section. So ship the pole back and see how they come apart. It should come apart with a quite resounding sort of thump like that. And when you take a pole apart, the joint needs to be level or behind you. Don't try to take it apart here. It's not very good that way because there's too much forward weight. So, and you want to take every one of these sections off. Bit of a problem, but you'll know then if there's any issues with the section sticking. So it's a bit like that. Happy with that. We're quite happy with that. So that's them. So you're quite happy with that. We'll go the other way because obviously this pole is going to spend half of its life going that way as much as it is going that way, although it'll probably spend longer that way. But it's the same thing, and see how they fit together. Remembering to keep the spine aligner together so the arrows are always at the top of the pole. And the idea of that is that when it's made and it's put on it's taped onto the mandrel, and it's actually they iron it across the top of the mandrel. The spine of the pole, which is where the two bits of carbon join, is always at the top, and that gives you the optimum stiffness and rigidity of the pole, whatever the pole, doesn't matter who makes it, they're all the same like that. So you want the section aligners all together. No knocking, you know, if there's a knock, just put it down and have a look at another model. There should never be a knocking in your pole, it should always be silent like that. And that is your joints looked at. Now, the other thing to do, you know, you have to be a bit careful with this, but when you get hold of the end of a section, just give it a squeeze, thumb and forefinger, not like that, you know, you don't need, it's not, you know, they are made of carbon and they are quite brittle. Just thumb and forefinger, bit of pressure, and you're looking for this bit. So this is the female end of any section to not oval. It should always stay round. Now, the section wall itself, midsection, they sometimes feel really flimsy, but that's not necessarily a bad thing. But just check for the anti-ovaling. And the sixth and the seventh sections of every pole are the weight loading sections, because poles are built from the tip down. And the sixth and the seventh sections are the sections that carry all the forward weight. So when you're going up to 14, 16 meters, they're the sections where the weight is, you know? So they need to be really tough, and they need to be very stiff, and they've always got the highest sort of carbon content, and maybe the use of pre-pregs in the carbon are used slightly differently, but they're the weight loading sections, and they're the ones that are the stiffest in your pole. There are lots of different finishes on poles, Suncore, Easy Glide, they all do much the same sort of thing. I think Suncore does prevent the pole from heating up as well on Mava poles, but the idea being that you can ship it really quick through your hands without a sticking. So stamp your fingers a little bit, because you're gonna have damp hands in your fishing, and then ship it. And you need to be able to ship it quickly and cleanly, and it doesn't want to stick. And that is what you're looking for. If most of your fishing is done at 13 meters or 12 meters, buy the best 12 or 30 meter pole you can. Do not buy the cheapest 16 meter pole you can find, because you're not going to use it, and your money is better spent on the length of pole that you're going to fish with. Because to buy a cheap 16 meter pole just because, oh, I've got a 16 meter pole, doesn't really work. Once you've decided what pole you want, it's now a case of looking at the package, and the package needs to suit your actual angling needs. Now, if you're doing a lot of silverfish fishing, you'll need match kits. You'll need more match kits than you will carp or power kits, because carp and power kits are pretty much one and the same, or F1 kits. Also, for lighter elastics when you're fishing for silvers, you don't necessarily need them fitted with side puller kits, but side puller kits on heavier elastics for commercials, that sort of thing, are an absolute must. And for me, every pole that you buy, if you fish commercials a lot, it needs to come pre-fitted with PTFEs, with a slot for a side puller kit, and with the side puller kit already fitted. I don't think there's any excuse these days to not have that in a pole, and it would be something that I would sort of really want. Now, not every pole on the market does come with these, and it's not a massive problem, but I'm not very handy with a drill and stuff like that. And then the thought of spending quite a lot of money and then giving it to someone to drill holes in to fit side puller kits isn't something I really want to do. Let's deal with light grey coloured kits and what on earth all that's about. Well, the idea is that Herons, I think it might have been Dennis White or even Tommy, I seem to be mentioning Tommy a lot these days, but basically thought, you see a heron, it's sort of walking around in the water, and the fish sort of don't notice them, you know, because it's nature's way. So it sort of made sense to do a light coloured pole kit, which maybe didn't spook the fish. And that's the main reason for them. They're supposed to be not spooking the fish. They do throw a shadow still, but they're sort of a non-spook. Now this one here, which is a one-piece one, is an F1 kit. And if you do a lot of commercial fishing and you really sort of enjoy your match fishing, then you'll need a couple of F1 kits, one piece of elastic through there, because mainly you're fishing with quite short or shallow rigs. And you need to be getting on with it sort of thing, you know, getting them out, because it's normally a fish race. And that's an F1 kit. This, although it's a, you know, a gray one, is a two-piece power kit. The match kits are much lighter, but when it comes to match kits and power kits, it's handy to have all your kits the same length, but a match kit doesn't necessarily, like I touched on, doesn't necessarily have to have that, but they do need to all be the same length. Your pole also needs to come in one of these. This is a cupping kit, an absolute necessity for any pole that you get, because you want to be able to feed and feed accurately. So you'll need a cupping kit. Also, you got things like this. This is a short four. What on earth is a short four? I can hear you asking. So a short fourth fits in here, on there. And the short four gives you either quite a long top kit. So if you've got deeper water, I find them like more handy for that. You get that extra bit of length if you're fishing very deep water, but also they stiffen. Yes, you lose a bit of length, but they really stiffen the pole up. So if you're catching very big fish, say shallow, which tend to surge off, the short four might stop an occasional accident, let's say. So there, short fours is handy if you get a couple of short fours with it. Mini extensions. normally fit in the butts, and they're normally reversible. So they'll like fit an eighth and a ninth, something like that. But the idea being, these are super tough. And let's just see what this one fits in. I think it goes in there. And if it's windy and, you know, very often you're really hanging on the pole like that, and there's a lot of force here on this area, down there where your elbow is. And when you go to sort of lift into a bite, your elbow can crack an ordinary section, but not with this fitted, not with these. They're really tough, and all poles come with them. Some of the more modern poles now come with section savers, so they're like mini, I'll show you what a skid bung is in a minute, but they're almost like skid bungs that fit in the end from, say, the sixth section down, and they work in a similar way, but they also, if you're shipping back through sort of foliage like this, it also stops these cutting, because obviously that is not going to ship back through anything that might go in there and stop you shipping back. Now, there was a time when you would, you know, you put your hook in the bottom here, and then your float would be here, and you tip exit, and you'd end up with a top kit that, that looked like it had been attacked with someone with a paint can. These days, it's all moved on, and we have depth markers, so you can put your float to these and you know exactly the depth you're fishing and what the depth is. So if you you know, if you're misfortunate enough to have a tangle or a rig snap or something, you can go back to the depth, and you, even if you're up like in the middle like that one, that's 2 foot, so let's say 2.5 foot, you'll know where to put your float. Most modern kits are like this now, but they are, depth markers are the way forward. A few essential items that may not come with your pole that you'll need. This is a skid bung. This is an adjustable one, so this little plastic bit expands and pushes against the foam. And skid bungs, or section savers as they're sometimes known, fit in the end there. And they, when you're shipping back, and this one has seen better days, they prevent damage and chipping to the end of your pole. They don't offer you anything in the way like they do with your elbow, but they do stop a lot of damage. And when it comes to looking after, especially your butt sections, what you don't want to be doing is having this look like a dog's chewed it. So that's a skid bung. This, tulips and socks. Socks to stop your pole sliding forward. If the bank's going up behind you, as most of them do, to be honest, you don't want your pole constantly going in there. You don't necessarily want to trap it in a tulip, because they're a little bit more aggressive, but you put your pole section into the tulip like that, and it's not going anywhere. This bit here, you can have a landing net on it, or you can just have it, you know, I sometimes just sort of put my top kit in there when I'm hooking a fish like that, and it just saves that. So they're time saving and safety saving things. Something I haven't got with me though, and it's to do with the actual body of the pole, is pole care. Now, you should always keep your pole as clean as you can. Always dry it off, so take a, you know, a cloth with you. Don't put it away damp. Wash it regularly inside. And one of the best things you can buy for it is something like Flash Dash, something that's got a silicone base in it, just cleaner, and just spray it on, clean it off with a dry rag, and you will find your pole absolutely flies through your hand. Now, there's been a lot of fishing matches won in fishing shops on a Friday, and I don't doubt poles are discussed, and I know they are in some earnest in fishing shops, but the facts are, to go out and actually fish with the pole is what you need to do. And obviously that's not always possible. And the chances are, when you talk about poles, your mate will have one that he says is brilliant and that you should have a look at, things like that. Last summer, I did notice one or two of the big manufacturers were out on the road doing road shows, particularly thinking Guru went to Aston Park in Sheffield, and you could actually have a look at the poles and have a fish with them. And that is a perfect way to test a new pole if you're thinking about, you know, a new pole. But the thing when you go outside fishing with a pole is, obviously, you know, you can see, you know, I can see the action of the pole and how much strength it's got, and do the sections hold up, and how does the joints work when it's under pressure, and all those things. But also you get the wind, and the wind, or the lack of it as we've got today, is a very important thing to consider when pole fishing. Now, lots of anglers, you know, they insist one of the first things they look at is how long it is, and then how much does it weigh. I never really do that, and I've looked at an awful lot of poles over the years. In fact, I can't think of one I probably haven't seen, and the weight of the pole doesn't really interest me, because I think, as long as it's not ridiculously heavy, the fact that when it's windy, a heavy pole tends to be a little bit more stable and easy to use. And let's be honest, if it really, you know, you can actually use a bump bar. I mean, I know some really good anglers that use bump bars, you know, so you can use a bump bar. should you need to, but don't be put off by something. As long as it doesn't feel too heavy for you to use, you know, don't be too worried or concerned about the weight. Oh, I can't have that, you know, because it weighs, you know, 20 grams more than my mates or than I think it should. Because the facts are that very often heavier poles have got a little bit more section wall thickness and are a little bit easier and stronger, especially in the wind, you know. I mean, most poles get broken and poles break. There is no such thing as, especially long pole, as an unbreakable pole. Don't happen. Sometimes they break in the wind. I've broken a couple, but when I've held on the section, you know, you put too much sort of energy into holding the pole and they're broken towards the butt section. But the most popular section for breakage is normally like a fifth or a sixth or a seventh, those three, because as you put them over the roller, like I said earlier, poles are designed from the top down, not the bottom up, and therefore the weight is in the, you know, the weight bearing load is in when the poles are going forward, not the other way. And if you don't have your roller in the right place, it can cause you a problem. I think the rule of thumb is four paces from your box and a roller, and then another four paces and a roller. So don't be afraid, you know, to have two, well, always have two, if not three rollers, but you know, that's where most of the breakages go. And double rollers are even better than single rollers. It's a fact, because the weight distribution is better over a double roller than it is a single. Anyway, we're at decoy and there's a typical decoy carp. And the water's warming up and they're getting livelier and livelier, and that's not a bad fish at all. If you've spent all that money on a pole, don't just throw it in a hodl. Get yourself a dedicated pole case. Everything's protected, it's all strapped in, it's not rattling around, no damage can come to it, and because it's hard case, you can transport it easily in your car. Most of the main manufacturers do them, and that will keep it safe and sound to and from the bank. Till next time.